Okay, we're going to do a short video today trying to explain something that I've been asked a few times, and that is, how is the thrust bearing attached to the main shaft of the engine? Now, it's easier to show this in a diagram than with the actual engine parts because of the way they're all arranged. So we're going to use the whiteboard. Here we are once again with our friendly whiteboard stuck to an LM2500 with duct tape. That's exactly what this is, it's duct tape. Okay, here is the compressor rotor stub shaft, the rear of the compressor of the LM1500. We're using that engine because it's the easiest one for me to explain. It makes the most sense, and you'll see that in a second. Okay, there's a shoulder on the rear of the compressor. The first thing is a rotating air seal. Okay, a rotating air seal. Then there's a rotating carbon seal race, which has a carbon seal that attaches up in here. Then what's stacked on top is the forward and then the rear inner races of the thrust bearing, which you've seen me install in the thrust bearing videos. All of these things have to be heated and slipped on down, but they're also compressed on with that special tool we have when they're cooling to make sure that all the clearance is taken up. So after the inner races of the thrust bearing are installed, the next thing that's shrunk on is the rear carbon seal inner race, the rear air seal inner race, finally a lock washer, and then these are threaded portions of the shaft, and this is the nut. Now let's take a look at those things in real life right now. Okay, here we are with the full stack of elements that go onto the rear of the compressor. This is the way they'd be sitting on the shaft. So first thing you'd do in removal is undo the nut. Okay, under the nut is the lock washer. There's a tab that goes into a slot in the shaft, and then whichever one of these tabs lines up with one of these slots, how does that look? Then you'd lock it. Okay, rear air seal. Right there. Let's do this upside down. Let's put it back together upside down over here. Okay. Rear carbon seal. And this is the rear one because it has a groove here that the pulling tool can engage with to pull it off the shaft. Okay. Now we've got the rear inner race. It also has a pulling groove. And the way this comes apart is we'll take the outer race with the balls with it. They do come out. This is a scrap rear bearing, or a scrap thrust bearing. So you need to put them in. And then set it down. Okay. Forward inner race. Forward carbon seal, and it's pulled off by the tool gripping this edge, inner race of the carbon seal. And finally, the forward air seal rotating element. And this is the shoulder here, the surface, which butts up against the shoulder on the stub shaft. So there's the whole assembly upside down. Okay, we've got an LM1500 compressor rotor on the balance stand, so we can see, or the balance machine, we can see here is the rear compressor shaft with the first air seal, the forward air seal still on it. The forward carbon seal would go there, the bearing race would slide over this part, the rear carbon seal there, and the rear air seal all takes up all the space. The nut goes on to this threaded portion, and that's what everything joins on to. Okay, this is the stack upside down. We're going to pretend to install them on the compressor rotor while we're putting the bearing into the engine. So first thing is the forward rotating air seal. Second thing is the forward rotating carbon seal inner race. I'll take the whole bearing here. Next thing would be the forward inner race of the thrust bearing. Then put the outer race with the balls, and you can see this profile here. We'll discuss that in a second. You put that in. Then the rear inner race of the thrust bearing. Then the rear rotating carbon seal. The rear rotating air seal. All these things have a flat surface on them to butt up against each other and transmit a great deal of axial force. And we put the lock washer in. And this nut has a left-hand thread, so it tightens in this direction. Put this on. This is the tool that we've built that we use to tighten the nut. Let me slip the nut onto the tool. Engages. It's quite a tight fit. There we go. Okay, this engages like that. I could squeeze this on, but then I wouldn't be able to get it off, so I'm not going to do that. It fits like this. And we put this on the shaft. Put this on there. And we tighten this nut to 600 foot-pounds. And that's what clamps everything in. And it's what clamps the inner races to the shaft. Okay, we've got all those pieces stuck on and torqued. And this is the outer race. I gotta redraw this. Okay, I've changed the drawing slightly to include this little profile at the rear face of the thrust bearing outer race. And that slips into the cavity in the midframe of the engine. And there's a little plate that goes on over top and is bolted and secures the bearing outer race in the case. And all these elements are stuck onto the shaft by this shoulder and the clamping force of this nut being torqued to 600 foot-pounds. Now, there doesn't need to be a great deal of locking force on the thrust bearing from keeping it from turning on the shaft, because the races are shrunk on thermally and it's a ball bearing. There's no real propulsive force or turning force exerted on the bearings by the balls unless you're in serious trouble, and then the engine's going to need complete overhaul if that does happen. Same thing with the outer race. It is clamped into the midframe, but there's no real torque on it. There's an axial load because it's a thrust bearing. But the only time there's going to be torque on the races is if the rolling elements are really messing up. They're either melting or being ground to bits, or it's a very serious problem and the whole engine's going to need to be overhauled. Now, when you're dealing with an engine that's on the vertical build stand and you're going to either remove the thrust bearing or put one in, of course you've already got a rotor jack installed. And let's take a look at a rotor jack that I built last week. This is in the Arenda turbojet, and there's a bolt circle there that which holds a plate on the front of the engine. So you just fabricate this plate, weld a nut to it. Where's the nut? It's on the other side. It's in there. Threaded rod, and it pushes against the front of the compressor rotor. And what that does is keep the compressor from falling out of the engine, or falling forward and crunching into bits of the engine when you remove the thrust bearing. So hopefully with the help of the diagram and seeing the parts for real in person right here, it's a bit more clear of how the thrust bearing is attached to the shaft in the J79 turbojet and LM1500 industrial turbine engine. A little bit, anyway. And now I'm going to show you why this bearing is scrap. Listen to this. And that's a piece of junk. Here's the factory GM overhaul manual for the 1500.
I meant to say GE, okay?
And there are 10 pages of instructions. 10 whole pages of instructions on how to do the installation of the thrust bearing.
Okay, that's it for this week. We've got turbofans, turbojets, gas generators, snowmobiles, space-age vans, everything in the shop. So once again, thanks for watching.